Hey everybody, it's the beginning of 2016 and I just got back from visiting my parents down on Vancouver Island, and on the way back I visited a buddy of mine that I used to work for, a very good friend. Thanks AJ. And he gifted me a bit of a project. He has given me his old and beaten on JBL L220s. Now, I don't know about you guys, but these are one of my favorite speakers of all time. There's some damage. Let's see. They were attacked at one time by somebody who was quite nasty, and they've slashed up the cones on both the woofers and the passive radiators. That damage was professionally repaired as best as possible some time ago. And since they've been in storage, very typically the foam surrounds have rotted away on the woofers. Look at that, just a mess, eh? And the passive radiators. But I checked out the left-hand speaker here because the foam was mostly there. I plugged it in and played a little bit. And the sound, even with deteriorating surrounds and the low frequency drivers, sound was awesome. Incredibly bright, crisp, and clear, with not thundering bass, but thumping bass. Yeah. So they're worth fixing. Anything this awesome, this incredible, from the 1970s, there's still parts available for it to fix. It's not that difficult to do. I've done it before. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna look these things over. We're gonna replace the surrounds in the low frequency drivers and the passive radiators. We're gonna replace the capacitors and the crossovers. We're gonna oil up the wood on the outside, and they're gonna be awesome. Yes. Look at those things. There's a very fitting song playing in the background, even though my videos don't have any music, because these speakers were introduced in 1979, and look at them. My goodness. Now, I'm not an expert audiophile historian. There's a lot more qualified people making videos out there about these things, but these are in what we might call neglected condition. You can see I've started putting a bit of oil on here. There's how it was, this is how it's gonna be. This one is as yet untreated, and it's pretty dry. My first project is to get in here. Let's see, this one I've taken all the bolts and screws out of. I want to get this off so I can get the crossover to replace the capacitors. Otherwise, these are incredible, incredible speakers. Yes. When I was 17 years old, I worked all summer and I spent every penny I made, $992, every penny, on a pair of JBL L110s. Those are 220s, and trust me, because I have them, four L110s do not equal two L220s. This is gonna be great. So we're gonna chronicle the restoration and the test at the end, and these are gonna be my primary number one home speakers. Awesome, what a score. Thank you, AJ, thank you so much. Now, back in the day when I had my, actually I still do have them, I've got a pair of L110s and a pair of 4313s. They said to take care of the oiled walnut finish with something like that. It's just lemon oil for wood. And so we're gonna put some on just because I want to document every step of the process. Why not? Just rub it in. I anticipate this being a several step process. We're gonna lay it on, let it soak in, and then we're gonna wait for a day or two, put some more on. Several applications of the oil, but you can see even the first slathering on, and the wood is just saying thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And these beautiful speakers, they have, let's get in better light. Oh, that's not too bad. This piece here is solid. This is probably solid American black walnut all the way down the front. We're gonna oil that up and make it happy. Okay, maybe you can tell that this one I haven't cleaned up at all. It's kind of dusty. And this one over here, I'd just given a light brushing with a paintbrush, a dry paintbrush to get rid of dust and things. Apparently this lens here, it's in front of a 5-inch driver, cone driver. That lens is quite in desire because it's no longer available. These are going to remain as stock as possible. I'm not going to replace these cones because they've been nicely repaired. This one, the surround is completely gone. So I'm going to replace the surrounds with parts that you can buy, readily available from many different sources. The cone, I think, is going to be fine because I'm not going to use them for heavy-duty sound reinforcement. And I can buy kits that replace the voice coil, the dust cap, the cone, and the surround for about $300 a piece. That's a little expensive for me. So I'm going to try with the $30 option, which is doing the surround repair or replacement myself, which I've done before. And we're going to go with that. These also need to be replaced, the passive radiator surrounds. They're gone. So my previous experience with replacing speaker surrounds was with this baby. I built this myself, the enclosure. It's kind of an ugly enclosure. But this is a 2245H, one of the most powerful bass drivers ever made. I got it fairly cheaply because the surround was gone. This one was completely blown. So I replaced the cone, voice coil, the dust cap, and the surround. And the results are astounding. Okay, it's a week later, and I'm still waiting for parts, but I did practice on the first one. Never mind the jet engine, this is the weekend. We're working on speakers. This one has been stripped and gutted. That piece of insulation there actually goes up into the separate chamber. That's what we're dealing with. We are going to start ripping this one apart and removing the surrounds from one of the bass drivers. So let's get started. All right, normally I'd be a lot more cautious and careful, but we're still not gonna wreck anything. We got our drill driver set in reverse. What we're doing here is we're gonna replace the surrounds anyway, but there's no sense being careless and stupid and punching this through a cone. Even though this cone has been almost completely destroyed and repaired, I'm just gonna take out the, they're not wood screws, they're machine screws. They go into T-nuts. As long as we're careful. Okay, so we just pop out. And luckily, these guys use spring-loaded terminals. It's not going to be hanging here for any great length of time. The wires are marked. And there you have a beautiful, amazing 14-inch JBL woofer, the LE14A. Let's put it on the shelf here. Okay, as we've discussed before, these speakers have had an attack. They've been ravaged and repaired with the proper glue. And these are incredibly good low frequency speakers. The first mention I can see of them in a JBL catalog is from 1960. And these speakers were made in 1979. And I know that the LE14, a version of it was used in the 250 Ti series. So it's a very long-lived driver. Let's put this on our turntable. Got a working turntable made naturally out of a thrust bearing from a J79 jet engine. I'm gonna put this on there and be able to turn it. Okay, it's gonna work pretty good. Pretty well, I should say. So we're gonna get a different tripod and start removing all this rotted crap. Okay, first thing we gotta do is remove this tiny little, let's see, there's a little rubber ring there. Bit of an unusual mounting system for the surround on this particular driver. So let's do that. It's not like most speaker surrounds. But we're gonna use our little separator here. It's glued in place with not a very strong glue. It doesn't need to be that strong. I'm glad it's not strong, otherwise this would be much more difficult job. We're doing the bottom edge. Look at how this surround material is just breaking up. I guess it's the oxygen in the air over decades combines with it and turns it into crap. I'm gonna work my way around the edge of this rubber mounting ring. I guess one good reason for not using the strongest glue possible was because then it would be really impossible to effect a repair. And then you'd have to make one of these rings. You could probably do it out of O-ring cord, but I'm gonna try to reuse the original pieces just because. Why not? I wanna restore this thing to its former glory if possible. Even with the scars, the wounded warrior. It's gonna sound awesome. It's gonna be great. That's why it's worth putting the effort into fixing this thing. So I'm being really careful not to touch the cone with the knife. And because we want to save it. Like I said, a new cone kit. There's one on eBay right now for more than $300 Canadian. So I'd need to buy two. And then with the new old stock cone kit, this rubber surround would be old stock. So it would be partially deteriorated. I don't know how good it would be. So I'm not gonna risk buying a new one unless I have to. Oh, here we go. That's the joint. I might have broken it, but we'll glue that back together. So what we use for the joint on that, just like an O-ring, we'll use super glue. But I would never use super glue to put the ring in because it dries too quickly and then it's difficult to remove. Okay, so it did come apart there. The other one came out just fine in one piece. All right, so now what we have to do is we've got to clean the residue and I think it is old contact cement from this mounting groove, and that's gonna take some time. It's gotta be perfectly clean, and then we're gonna clean it from the back of the cone. Okay, another use for this gasket scraper, palette knife, whatever you wanna call it, is this rubber removal, because it won't, if you're careful, it won't cut the paper. It's not a knife blade. It'll just scrape, and it'll bounce off the paper. Won't cause any damage. I almost forgot one thing. One of the ways I like to protect the cone when I'm working on the edge of the basket or the frame is you're going to put something that's chemically resistant to cleaners and such around the edge of the cone. Okay. Now I can spray and brush and do all kinds of stuff there without worrying about getting anything on that white cone. Cool. Okay, we found that it is rubber cement at least part of the way around. So what I've done is, I don't want to scratch the brushed aluminum face with our steel brush, but I'm using the square end of the handle, a little bit of carb cleaner. This carb cleaner is very nasty and it's dissolving the rubber cement that's 35 years old quite nicely. Got to go through it a few times and then use the square edge of the handle to sort of scrape it out. When I get to the point where I'm going to be brushing out that groove with the steel bristle brush, I'm going to mask off the front of this beautiful brushed aluminum faceplate with tape so that I won't leave a scrubbing mark all the way around it. Okay, it's about an hour later. We've got our frame masked off with, I like electrical tape because it's a bit more resistant to being torn by the brush. We've got our stainless steel bristle brush. We're just going to dry scrape this groove clean. And I guess if there's any residue left on it, after that, we're going to pick at it. And it's going to be clean enough to have the new surround glued in. What I'm going to do with these A lot of people say you should cut the dust cap off and shim the voice coil when you put a new surround on. That would be especially necessary in this one because it moves around so easily. And when you press that plastic piece in, you can't do it perfectly. So you may have some side-to-side forces which may affect not so much the spider. The spider is quite resistant to radial movement, but you can tilt this up and down, and that's gonna affect the voice coil. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna glue the rubber surround into the frame first, and then I'm gonna glue it to the cone. So the very stiff tensile forces put on the surround by pushing it into this frame with a plastic ring and some glue, we'll let those all do whatever they want. And then you're gonna have the inner of the surround glued to the outer of the cone, and things will just naturally settle into place with a very light touch. And we're gonna do it that way. So if you guys think that that's the wrong way, then I will be joining you in failure and we'll replace the whole thing again. But I'm gonna try to avoid cutting out the dust cap just because. So there we go. It's already a very time-consuming process, and I don't want to spend forever on it. But you can see this has come up quite nicely. Quite nicely. All right, this is our secret weapon. Nice, clean, semi-clean, dry, never used paintbrush. We're getting the black bits and dust out of the somewhat porous surface of the white cone. Okay, so we're ready to take off our masking. See what it looks like. Looks to me like it is cleaned and ready for gluing in the new surround. Another thing I did was I slightly scrubbed the face of this with Scotch-Brite to make it newishness looking. And now what we've got to do, I can take it off the turntable. We've got to remove the crap and the glue from there, from the back side of the cone. Now it looks like they used some of that speaker adhesive on there, so this could be interesting. But again, it's a project and a journey. It's gonna be great. Hey everybody, we're back at the shop. It's now the next week. We're still waiting for capacitors for the crossovers. And I've done the passive radiator just because it's all very standard, very easy to glue up, and they don't have voice coils, so it's very simple. So we're gonna do the woofer and our wounded warriors from the 70s. And I got the kit from these guys, but there's the ones I've done before were from Simply Speakers. They're all good, they're very easy. And I am no expert, I'm just gonna do this to prove that any hack can fix an expensive set of speakers. And I was watching some reviews of some newer speakers today, and they're great, they're fantastic, they're probably better. But for some reason, I just like the big old earth shakers from the 70s, and why not, eh? I work on jet engines from the 50s and 60s, so from the 1970s, it's like a major leap forward in technology to me. All right, so all you get with the kit is a rubber or a foam surround and a bottle of glue. And I'm always freaked out because I think I'm gonna run out of glue because I have to do 8 joints with this, whatever, 2-ounce bottle of glue. There's always enough. There's always enough, and it cleans up with water, so it's very simple, and it takes a long time to dry, so you can't get yourself in trouble like with contact cement. So what we're gonna do, the reason I wanna show this is a couple things. It's a different way of mounting the surround, and also I'm gonna do it backwards. They suggest that you cut the center dome and glue the surround to the back of the speaker, and then shim the voice coil and then glue the surround to the frame. But you see, this plastic ring is gonna squeeze the frame, the surround into place, and it could cause some uneven tension, whatever. And the force of the slight springiness of the spider is never going to center it once it's pressed in. However, if I glue in the surround first into the frame, let it dry, and then if I turn this over, the bench pushes on the cone of the woofer evenly all the way around, a nice flat surface, and I'll just put the glue in behind and let it set. It should be perfectly centralized. That's the theory. Anyway, I have mixed up some of the glue with some water. I like to paint it on with a brush as opposed to spreading it like peanut butter. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to zoom in a little bit to the frame and the cone here, and we're going to do it. Yes, a hack like me can do it, so I think you can do it. All right, I've got this thing handily mounted on a turntable, which is going to be great. I also like to have all kinds of extra paper towels and stuff laying around, just because you don't want to be reaching for that kind of stuff when you make a mess. You want to have it right there. So all I'm going to do is paint this into the little 90 degree, what would you call this, a sill or a mounting diameter. Doesn't need a whole lot, because as a matter of fact, I thought this was going to be a difficult woofer to rehab because it's got a different mounting system, but rather than just having the glue hold the thing in place and figuring out a way to press the glue together and clamp it and try to make things stay where they are while the glue dries, that magic plastic ring does that for you. It's like magic. And trying to get the surround around the speaker is a lot like putting a bicycle tire on a bicycle wheel. It's smaller in diameter than the cone, but you'll figure out, you'll see. It'll be real easy. There's nothing to stress about. And again, this glue takes a long time to dry, so we're not worried about anything. Even if we have to mix up more, if we run out, we've only got like a quarter ounce or eighth of an ounce of it made up here. If we run out, we'll mix up more, we're not gonna panic. Everybody's happy, everything's cool, and we'll get these dinosaurs working again. I've had them in the shop now for about 2 weeks waiting for parts and supplies and whatever, and I'm getting pretty excited about listening to them when they get restored. I was looking at a couple of reviews, and there's some amazing speakers out there called the Studios. Studio 530s, and the top of the line in that JBL line of speakers are the Studio 590s, and I've decided that the 220, the L220, is the spiritual ancestor of the Studio 590, because what they do with the Studio series is they align the origin of the sound, the voice coil of the compression driver and the woofer, they align them in the same vertical plane, which is exactly what the L220 does. The L220 has a 5-inch cone driver instead of a compression driver, but it's got a compression driver tweeter, and the Studio 590 is essentially a two-way speaker. We've got two 8-inch drivers, woofers, and the compression driver mid-range tweeter, which they're very powerful. They're just amazing devices. Okay, so we've got this. We're gonna try to get it in there, and it just works great. We're not gonna get any glue on the back of it. It's just not a problem. It looks like it's, you'd think it was so complicated and you're gonna freak out about getting glue all over everything. It's no big deal. Of course, the other one went better. Just feeding it in there. We're not worrying about putting the glue, putting the surround in the glued slot just yet, because it'll be held in place very nicely by the plastic ring, which is a great invention. Now we get to the part where it's going to stretch a bit. Still, no worries. This foam is very elastic and compliant. The cone is very stiff. Okay, we're halfway there. We're going to take our favorite little tool, the painter's palette knife, and just shove it down there. Bash it down into the little corner so that we don't trap the foam between the frame and the plastic ring, because the plastic ring is just big enough to fit in there. It wouldn't allow anything behind it or it would buckle. And that wouldn't be a problem. We just pull it out and redo it. This glue is extremely forgiving.
There's a reason they sell DIY speaker kits, because it's easy. It's very easy. So never throw away a set of speakers when the foam surrounds are all rotten. That does happen. Okay, now I'm going to put another bead of glue on top and to the side of this to help everything get happy. And again, if I get some on the frame, not a worry. I've got like half an hour to clean it up with water. Cleans up with water. No problem. I'm trying to be careful, but it's not that critical. You won't be able to see this stuff when it dries. Okay. I'm getting real short on glue here. Oops. I'll get that with some water when we're done. Not a problem. Not a problem. When I did my first set of speakers like this, I was so paranoid and scared and nervous and freaked out. It's easy. It works. The results are amazing. They're just fantastic. And it's especially good because you know that you did it yourself. Yeah. Okay, just about there. I'll probably edit out some of this boring stuff. I will. Okay, we're almost all the way around. Then the fun part begins. And by fun, I mean fun, I don't mean hard. It's really easy. Okay, we're just about out of glue here. Okay, see the mess we've made? No problem. I'm just gonna put this plastic ring in. There's a joint on here. Right there. For some reason, I wanna put it here, pointing to the leads. Something like that. We'll just get it basically started. And then we'll push it down in, and it pushes the surround into place. It's just fantastic. You've got a similar gap all the way around. It's almost done. Now what we're gonna do is, because this plastic is flush with the frame, when we're done, we're gonna put it on a flat surface and let it dry. But first, we're gonna do a bit of cleaning up with our handy dandy water. Okay, sort of moist there. Look at this. And those white bits in there, they'll completely disappear. I just want to get it off the front like that. Isn't that amazing? It's actually that easy. Get it off the frame. Now this plastic ring wants to come up a bit. It's holding down squishy foam. So, what we have amongst the mess is a what's known as a surface plate. It's polished granite, flat to within a zillionth of an inch. You don't need something like this. A countertop, a nice flat table, even the floor would work, except you don't want to step on your speaker when it's drying. We're going to place it on the flat surface and let the weight of the speaker push the plastic ring into place, and that'll be half the job of rehabilitating an LE14A with a cut open and re-stitched together Frankenstein cone, 1970s powerhouse. So we've got this wonderful piece of dinosaur technology from the 70s. I'm gonna place it upside down on this surface. And the whole thing weighs about 15 pounds. It's a giant, I don't think this is an Alnico magnet. It might be. It does look like one. Might be a ferrite, but it looks like an Alnico. Anyway, it's gonna push the plastic cone up in there, or the plastic ring. Then what we've gotta do.
Okay, we've got it drying. We're gonna put the glue in there next. So, that'll be the last step, and then this thing will be ready to rock. Ready to rock.
So as you can see, this one's fully disassembled. We're gonna do a complete rehab. Passive radiator, woofer, and we're taking a look at the mid-range, and we are cleaning out the high-frequency ring radiator. We're also gonna replace the capacitors in the crossovers. And right now, after a couple of weeks of putting oil on this every once in a while, it's turned out pretty well. A good spot there. Bit of paint. Oh no! I'll get that off later. Anyway, looks fantastic. Don't you think? Better than the dried out piece of crap it was before. So I'm getting excited. I can't wait. It's going to be another week or so before we can hook these up. And I'm going to try to wait until they're both done and have my reaction to hearing them for the very first time on video. All right. I'm getting excited.